Welcome to World Health News with Dr. David Samadi. Dr. Samadi is the Chairman of Urology and Chief of Robotic Surgery at Lenox Hill Hospital. Dr. Samadi is in the studio to answer your questions regarding your health. Call 1-877-970-2999. That's 1-877-970-2999. Here now is Dr. Samadi.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to World Health News. I hope you're having a calm and peaceful Sunday. We have a full show for you. For about an hour, we're bringing the world experts in every field, and we're going to have talking about screening. We'll talk about a little bit about robotic surgery for colon cancer. We'll talk about whether you should be screening or not, and also my good friend Dr. Siegel just arrived, and he's going to be talking a little bit about Obamacare. Is it good for us or not? Are we better off now than 2 years ago? Are patients benefiting from this or not? And what are the issues? And we're going to try to break this. Clearly, the emphasis of this is mostly on men's health and women's health, obviously. As a urologist, I look for topics that are healthy for you, and it's coming from international exposures. In Netherlands, there's a huge news coming in about the use of MRI and how we're going to use MRI-guided biopsy. And I'm going to be talking about that. We also have a great blog that just went up a couple of days ago. If you miss something, it's all going to be there, all the videos and pictures and information. It's going to be on samadimd.com. Samadimd.com is our new blog, and we're going to be basically posting this. Now, why are we doing this? We used to have a men's health show, which was a little more focused. Now I want to bring in the experts, not only from U.S., but also internationally. We're going to have everything surrounding medicine, whether it's going to be medical technology, medical app, the business of medicine, and the politics of medicine. And we see all these hospitals are merging. We see urgent care coming up. Are we moving too fast? Is the quality of care changing? And what you should be doing as a patient to be aware of your health and be your best advocate. So let's get started. Let me just talk to you about, like, we've spoken about elevated PSAs, prostate cancer. We still have about 27,000 men die from this disease. And, you know, our old-fashioned random biopsy may or may not have been a good technique to detect this. Now, the latest press that came out even this week from Lenox Hill is that we have the only Euronav MRI-guided biopsy. And if you have any questions about elevated PSA, prostate or prostate health, you can call our center, 212-365-5000, 212-365-5000. We are able to use these MRI biopsies to find and target the lesion. Instead of randomly shooting across the prostate and miss the focus of cancer, we're able to detect them better. We're able to use the 3 Tesla MRIs, find out where the lesions are, and just focus on those areas. And that's what's going on in our center. This was based on a study of 1,000 men, and we're finding out that the MRI-guided biopsy results in 30% higher chance of finding aggressive prostate cancer, which is what's important. We don't necessarily want to know about those indolent prostate cancers, and that's the reason why we're using this MRI-guided biopsy. So if you have any questions, always call us, and that was a big, exciting news over here. Now, the biggest thing that made it in U.S. this week was about the link of prostate cancer and breast cancer. So if any of your first-degree relatives have prostate cancer, your father, brother have prostate cancer, that increases the risk of breast cancer in the family. Genetics plays a big role. We know about the gene BRCA1 and BRCA2, which is really important. So if your father have prostate cancer, the daughters need to be more aware and get the mammogram and get the screening done and making sure. Right now, we're having a lot of issues with guidelines and recommendations from U.S. Task Force. As you heard, there are issues with PSA levels. Should you be getting them when you're 40 years old, or should you be getting them when you're 55? And I hope that one day AUA, American Urological Association, will wake up and will really consider earlier screening for prostate cancer. We're finding out younger men coming in with very aggressive prostate cancer, and this wasn't the case when we had the old guidelines. Now with the new ones, we're catching the disease later. We're really finding more aggressive prostate cancers, and that cannot be good. And we also have Dr. Craig Wax, who is a family physician, who hopefully will be calling in soon In fact, he's online. So let me introduce you to Dr. Craig Wax, who's a good friend. He is a family physician calling in from New Jersey. He is also known as a doctor of all media. He is pro-health, pro-screening, and he also has his own radio show on 89.7 WGLS FM in New Jersey. Dr. Wax, good morning. How are you today?
Good morning, Dr. Samadi. Thank you for having me, and greetings to your audience.
Thank you very much. All right, so you're the first line of place where patients come to see you. As a family physician, you decide whether you should screen or not, should you get the PSA or not, should they go for mammogram. What's on the ground level at the physician, family physicians? What is the thinking, and what is your thought on this?
That's a great question, Dr. Samadi. In fact, I definitely recommend patients every year come in, no matter what the age. I see patients from 1 week of age all the way through to senior citizens and a hospice care. And I recommend every patient come every year for several different reasons. There's a lot of conflicting information out there right now. The government, the third-party payer system, Medicare, Medicaid, as you mentioned, the United States Preventive Services Task Force, everybody's looking for every reason not to pay for routine screening. But it's almost like taking care of your car. I mean, would you not change your oil every 3 or 4 months based on use? Of course you would, and yearly you would do certain things. It's the same thing with your body. Taking care of your body is a very, very important thing to do. In fact, it's the most valuable thing we have. Everything we have comes from our health.
All right, so just like wait right there, because I want people to know if they have questions about screening, to call our station, 877-970-2999, 877-970-2999. Let me explain to you why the government doesn't want people to get screening. I mean, cost obviously is part of it. But they're also worried that if you find cancers that are not really aggressive, they're indolent cancers, then they may not really affect the patients. We are overdiagnosing and we're overtreating. That's really the argument against screening. And of course, in the field of prostate cancer, they talk about incontinence and impotence. And if the cancer wasn't going to kill them, then we just ruined their life. My take on that is, you know, we need to understand the PSA better. We need more alternative tests. We need to get better genetic tests and better surgeons. Train our robotic surgeons, our laparoscopic surgeons. If we have good outcome, then screening has a lot of benefits, and there's an art to screening. And what do you say about that?
Dr. Samadi, you're absolutely right. We're in total agreement. I do PSA exams, which are blood tests, prostate-specific antigen for anybody out there that's wondering why we're throwing around initials. I do digital rectal exams on all males. You know, I start my screening by 50 years old, and if they have risk or first-degree family history, we start even younger than that. And it has to be individualized based on a person. It can't be based on a guideline or a government rule. It has to be based on the person. But for your yearly physical, it's important, you know, if you're a male, to consider whether PSA and digital rectal exam is right for you, with the information that your doctor can share with you and the information you've gathered yourself. And as you mentioned, the female component of all this, mammograms, breast exams, pap smears, you know, that's also kind of come under fire, and wrongfully so. I mean, there should be a discussion back and forth, but ultimately it comes down to you and your physician. And that's another reason that yearly physical exams are important. It helps strengthen the physician-patient relationship, which is very important. It's a great time to catch up, as you know, Dr. Samadi, on your patient's history and your family history if they see you on a yearly basis, especially if they have risk. It also allows for a physician to check up all body systems, just like your car getting checked up, is the analogy that I'd raised before. Also, it's important to have a physician monitoring your lifestyle choices and options.
I think
are you drinking too much coffee? Are you drinking alcohol? Are you smoking? Most Americans, I think at least half of us, are overweight, if not obese, and that's a risk factor for all kinds of metabolic problems.
Well, in this show,
disease.
Yeah, absolutely. Dr. Wax, sorry to interrupt you, but in this show, we're a big fan of coffee, and we've talked a lot about the benefits of coffee and also the fact there was a study last week about MS and also in Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. But you're right. I think, you know, you guys are in the front line talking about obesity, diabetes, blood pressure, etc. One other question before we go for a quick break. You know, shortage of family practitioners. They want to bring nurse practitioners who they claim that it's as good as you guys. Now they want them to prescribe, diagnose, screen. What do you say about that? You know, given the shortage of doctors
that.
In the future.
It's definitely an issue, because as the government and third-party payer system tries to force physicians out, because we're expensive to create, Dr. Samadi, as you know, that we are at least 11 years in the making, and all of the time and money that goes into that, and nurses are probably a little more than half of that. And don't get me wrong, I mean, nurses are the care element in a hospital or inpatient healthcare center or a nursing home. They are the care element. However, I don't think they can do the same job as a physician can do because of the training difference.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think they're an important part of healthcare, but there are some limitations to what the family practitioners do, surgeons, and also the nurses. Completely different training. I appreciate you being on the show. We're going to have you more often. I know you are doing a lot of collaboration with Independent Doctor Association, and I appreciate your take on screening and giving your Sunday time to us. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, I want to talk about colon cancer. We talked a little bit last week, but what treatment options are available? We have my good colleague from North Shore LIJ in Huntington, Dr. David Rivadeniro, coming in, talking about robotic surgery for colon cancer. And if you have questions, call 877-970-2999. And we're going to take a nice break with my usual music, and we'll come right back.
De rodillas, luna, no te vayas, alúmbrale la noche a ese corazón desilusionado, a veces maltratado.
No te perdonaré si me dejas solo con los sentimientos.
Just move it. All right, guys, we're back again. World Health News with Dr. Samadi. I'm the chair of urology at Lenox Hill Hospital. We're bringing you not just the medical news from U.S., but from all over the world. And I'm bringing the expert in the field who really know what they're doing, and you deserve better. And to make sure that you get not just the expertise, but also about medical apps, how to improve your quality of health, and also about talk about the politics. For the next 45 minutes, if you have questions, call 877-970-2999. If we don't get to you, you can call my office at 212-365-5000. And everything is going to go on samadimd.com. Samadimd.com. We're here with our colleague from Huntington Hospital, part of North Shore LIJ, and I'm also proud to be part of that system from Lenox Hill. I don't know how many hospitals we have. Every week, Mr. Dowling is buying another hospital, so I think we're up to 21 or 22, but it's growing. It's a great healthcare system. We have the director of colorectal surgery at Huntington Hospital, Dr. David Rivadeniro. Perfect. He does a lot of robotic surgery for colon cancer. We spoke about colon cancer that affects about 140,000 men and women out there. About 50,000 die from this disease. If you catch it early, it's treatable. And you look for blood in the stool, change of caliber in your stool, and weight loss, and many other things. So, David, welcome to the show. Thank you for being here. And tell us a little bit about screening. Who should get colonoscopy? I talked a little bit about Cologuard last week and who should get what. That it would be great.
Well, good morning, Dr. Samadi. Thank you for having me.
My
what
pleasure.
A great show.
Thank you.
And thank you for bringing the awareness to the public about March being Colon Cancer Awareness Month. So there's a big initiative in March to get the word out that this is an extremely preventable but yet curable process if someone is diagnosed with it. So the prevention, as you had your primary doctor earlier on the show, prevention is key, you know, so a good healthy diet and high in fruits and fiber and vegetables and low in red meat is very important. We know that certainly there are genetic components associated with this. A strong family history of other cancers. You mentioned breast cancer and being associated with prostate cancer. We feel the same way in colon cancer. If you have an early diagnosis of uterine, ovarian, gastric, renal cancers, breast cancer, then you should probably be screened for colon cancer as well.
Are you seeing the same kind of changes in screening in colon cancer also? I know with breast cancer and prostate cancer, there's a lot of controversy, discussion about who and what age you should be getting screened. Is that what's going on in colon cancer too?
There is, although I think, you know, there has been a tremendous positive impact about getting the word about screening colonoscopy.
That's right.
And we saw that when Katie Couric had her colonoscopy many years ago on Good Morning America. We saw that Katie Couric effect happen where people just came and had their colonoscopies done.
The celebrity factor is
always
helpful.
Absolutely, absolutely. And we've seen, unlike other cancers, we've seen a downward trend in the number of deaths related to colon cancer. So we're making great strides in terms of this. And it has to do with awareness. It has to do with screening colonoscopy. So anybody at the age of 50 or over should have a screening colonoscopy. If you have a strong family history, you should have it done earlier. If you have any symptoms and you mention, yes, blood in the stool, that is never normal. Anemia, never normal. Changes in the caliber or the consistency of your bowel movements, you should see a physician to see if you should get evaluated for a colonoscopy or other methods. You mentioned Cologuard. As long as something is done, right. I think that's the important thing.
Look, I think people are scared of that prep. The truth is that prep is a little difficult. Sometimes it causes bloating and abdominal pain. And I also found out that 50% of people over the age of, 25% of people over the age of 50 are still not getting colonoscopy, which is unbelievable, either from lack of knowledge or education or they're afraid of those preps. Can Cologuard play a role, at least to get the first foot in, by getting tested, how accurate it is, and exactly what kind of test is Cologuard?
Well, so Cologuard is looking at genetic abnormalities in the actual stool. And it has been approved now as a screening modality. Now, we know that the gold standard is colonoscopy.
Absolutely.
But colonoscopy is an invasive procedure. And there are, unfortunately, patients who have complications related to colonoscopy. There are patients who will never have a colonoscopy. So, therefore, there should be other tests that should be done. Cologuard is one of them. Virtual colonoscopy is another test that is acceptable as well. And certainly, we're fortunate enough in the tri-state area that we are surrounded by really wonderful healthcare systems and professionals. But patients in other areas of the country that have limited access to healthcare, guaiac stools or cards where you can test microscopic blood in combination with other tests like a sigmoidoscopy is also acceptable. Again, I think in a tri-state area, colonoscopy is the gold standard, but there are other things like Cologuard, like virtual colonoscopy that is acceptable.
We're speaking to my colleague, Dr. David Rivo-Dinero, Director of Colorectal Surgery at Huntington Hospital, who is the expert in colon cancer. We just heard from him about screening and how important it is to screen and get your colonoscopy. And for a lot of people who need to reach him, we're going to put his information. We'll take a quick break. And when we come back, I want to talk to him about robotic surgery. Given the fact that he's Italian, he deserves a nice Italian music. And here we go.
Americano, si è da me chi tu fa fa. Tu vuoi vivere alla moda, ma se bevi whisky and soda, poi ti senti disturba. Tu abballo rock and roll, tu gioca a baseball, ma i soldi per Camella, chi te li dà la borsetta di mamma? Tu vuoi fare l'americano, americano, americano. Ma se nati in Italia, siente a me non c'è sta niente a fa. Ok, napolitan, tu fa l'American, tu fa l'American.
come da bocca pigli te va bene, si do la parla mia americana.
All right, I hope you enjoy our music. I had one guy in the last year or so who said, I'm annoyed by your music because I want to hear more about the science of it. But I think a lot of women out there are dancing with us. They're opening this Sunday morning with their coffee, and they're happy. And that's part of our life, and that's who I am. And so we're here with Dr. David Rivadeneira, director of Colorectal from Huntington, who's going to be talking about now latest treatments for colon cancer. And I know when I was through training, we used to cut people open, take the whole part of the colon. The recovery was long. What's the latest? What's new in your field? What are we doing as far as technology when it comes to colon cancer?
So, Dr. Samadi, we've made tremendous strides in terms of the treatment of colon cancer. The listeners need to understand that this is an extremely curable process. So if you are diagnosed with an early stage colon cancer, stage one, stage two, the survival rates, the chance of you living the rest of your life without battling cancer is extremely high, 85 to 99%. Those rates of survival drop down as the cancer becomes more later stage. But even with stage three colon cancer, when the cancer has gone to the lymph nodes, there's still excellent survival of 60% with chemotherapy.
And what's the first line of treatment?
The first line, no doubt, is still surgical resection. Removal of the tumor along with all the lymph nodes in the surrounding area is still the mainstay treatment. Chemotherapy is only given to those patients that have tumor that have spread to other areas of the body. So surgery is still the mainstay. And you mentioned, yes, when we trained many years ago, the treatment was done through a large incision, what we call a laparotomy. That is less and less often now. We do surgeries more minimally invasive, either laparoscopic or currently robotically many times. And this offers patients a tremendous benefit because the incisions are much, much smaller. Instead of a 2-foot incision, you're talking about 1-inch or 2-inch incisions usually.
So we're talking about robotic surgery for colon cancer. And obviously in my field, we do robotic surgery for prostate cancer. We look for those delicate nerves for responsible for sexual function, for continence. I know you do a lot of robotic surgery for colon cancer. Explain to me, is there an incision? What does it take? How many days in the hospital so the audience understand what's going on?
So usually for the robotic approach for colon cancer or rectal cancer, there are several small incisions. So there are a couple of small incisions, usually one around the belly button area. That's where the camera goes in. And then we may have 2 or 3 small incisions for the actual robotic arms or the ports that assist us in doing the surgery to detach the colon, to detach the blood vessels.
Less invasive.
Less trauma tissue, tissue trauma, less bleeding. We definitely are able to visualize the nerves and the tissues much better with the robotic approach. It allows us access to different areas of the abdomen in the lower pelvic area for people with rectal cancer particularly, so we can see much better than through an open procedure and even better than a laparoscopic procedure. So the surgeries usually take on average anywhere from 1.5 hours to about 3 hours, depending on what type of procedure, how extensive. Body habitus of the patient is extremely important. We know that patients who are obese or super obese, these are more difficult procedures, so they take a little bit longer. Patients' average stay in a hospital is anywhere from 2 to 4 days. And the recovery, I think full recovery takes them about 2 weeks. This is a tremendous improvement, say, compared to open surgery, where they would stay at least a week in a hospital, and true recovery would take about 8 to 12
weeks.
It's
a huge difference.
Huge difference.
Look, we're talking about colon cancer, and you don't really need to die from this disease. He just talked about screening, the fact that you can get colonoscopy. Maybe it's not fun, but you do it once every, what, every 10 years after the age of 50, depending on family history?
Depending on family history and what is found on a colonoscopy. So if polyps are found, then they need to be repeated sooner, anywhere from 3 to 5 years.
There you go. So, and there are many different things that you can do. The colon sheds a lot of DNA cells that can find in simple tests. Give him a call. I know you work very closely with a lot of GI doctors. They do colonoscopies sometimes at the same time to find where the cancer is, and you can remove it with good outcome. That's amazing.
Absolutely. So, a collaborative environment, this is one of the important things about a health system as large as North Shore LIJ. We work well together with multiple specialties to bring the best outcome to patients. So, again, for your listeners, get yourself screened, get your loved ones screened. It's very important. March is Colon Cancer Awareness, and spread the word around because it'll save truly thousands of lives.
Well, I appreciate you being here. And also during the commercial, I found that he's half Italian and half Spanish. So this, you got the Italian part. Now you're going to get the Spanish part.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank
We're going to put this information online for everyone.
Great to be here.
Pero bueno, ya lo saco donde no te vayas ahora y no tú, que esto se compone, que no te me vayas ahora, que esto se compone, Carlito, si un juramento y no lo cumplí, por mujer no lloro, Carlito.
All right, I want to talk to you about one of our sponsors for the show, which is PrivateGym.com. We know that millions of men in the U.S. are prescribed medication for erectile dysfunction every year. Thousands of them are taking these medications, but some side effects. So if you don't want to take Viagra, Levitra, Cialis, because you're worried about the side effects, go to PrivateGym.com, PrivateGym.com, and we'll post this on our Twitter. Thank you so much.
Give Dr. Samadi a call now for all your health questions. 1-877-970-2999.
Hello, AM 970 listeners. This is Mike Lindell, the inventor of MyPillow. I'm celebrating my company's 10-year anniversary with a very special offer for all of you. You can take 50% off every single product I carry. Now is the perfect time to get your first MyPillow or give one for a gift. I feel so blessed. MyPillow was just named the official pillow of the National Sleep Foundation. I give a 10-year warranty that it won't go flat, a 60-day money-back guarantee. You can throw it in the washer and dryer so it stays healthy for the whole 10 years. And I guarantee it's going to be the most comfortable pillow you'll ever own.
For the MyPillow 50% sale, call 1-800-651-0798 and use the promo code AM970. You can also go to MyPillow.com, but make sure you use the promo code AM970. Don't miss out on the MyPillow 10th anniversary sale by mentioning AM970 when you call 1-800-651-0798 and use the promo code AM970. That's 1-800-651-0798, promo code AM970.
Is joint pain, limited mobility, or a sports injury stopping you from living your life? At the Human Motion Institute at Raritan Bay Medical Center, their goal is simple: to return you to normal function as quickly and safely as possible. Their team of experienced orthopedists, surgeons, and physical therapists, along with your very own nurse navigator, work with you to develop a customized treatment plan to get you back to the activities you enjoy. By combining extensive clinical expertise with a compassionate, caring treatment philosophy, they've created a program known for its quality of care. To learn more about the Human Motion Institute at Raritan Bay Medical Center, call 855-566-8466, 855-566-8466. That's 855-566-8466, or visit rbmc.org. That's rbmc.org.
Dr. Samadi is taking all your health questions now. Call 1-877-970-2999.
Good morning again. Happy Sunday. Dr. David Samadi, Chair of Urology here. We are starting this whole brand new show, World Health News, and we have unbelievable guests and doctors and hopefully even politicians in the future to talk about healthcare. Where are we headed? What we should know about, etc. My good friend and colleague, Dr. Mark Siegel, is in the studio. We see each other every Sunday on Sunday House Call, who's been helping everybody. Now he was nice enough to come to the studio. I want to talk to him about Obamacare very soon. I also want to talk to him about some of the initiatives that he has in pediatrics, obesity, and diabetes, child obesity that we're going to be talking today on Fox News. But I want to answer some of the calls, and maybe I even get you involved, Mark. Let's go to Grace from Staten Island. Grace, good morning. Dr. Samadi here.
Dr. Samadi, thank you so much for taking my call. I watch you all the time on Fox.
Thank you.
And I heard you an interview with Frank Morano, so that's how I knew about this show. And I'll be honest, I'm going to be 60 this year. I haven't taken really good care of myself, and I'm maybe taking a late start. What foods would prevent cancer? My mom died of that at an early age, and
She died from what disease, if I can ask you, Grace?
Breast cancer. She had a lump, but at those days they didn't.
Of course.
She saw a doctor. They didn't say, "Oh, don't worry about it."
Grace, first of all, thank you very much for being a fan and also trying to improve your health. That's what we are here for. To change your life and many other lives. And all of the information that I'm going to give you is going to be on our blog, SamadiMD.com. SamadiMD.com. I'm glad you listened to Frank Morano. He's a very energetic man on the radio, and this AM 970 is doing all the good things to bring awareness. I think, given the fact that you have history of breast cancer and family history of that, you should be on top of the game with your mammograms, and also there are now MRIs to really detect if there are any kind of lesions and be very aggressive in biopsying them if you find something unusual. We heard from our good doctor about colonoscopy and our family practitioner about getting your pap smears and everything else in order. But as far as diet is concerned, anything that can cause inflammation, it can lead to cancer. That's a very simple, basic way of doing it. So fatty food, red meat, things, processed food, all of those are obviously not good for you. And I've always told people, you've heard me say this on Fox News, look at your plate. If it's all color, then it's a good thing. So fruits, vegetables. I mean, once in a while, we're all human beings. You can deviate from the norm. But for the most part, you know, stick to all of those. Get your colonoscopy, get your mammogram, and we can even ask, and if you have questions and you don't have a medical doctor, Dr. Siegel is here. Mark, good morning.
Good morning,
Dr.
David.
Siegel, let me introduce him. He's a professor of medicine from NYU Langone. He's extremely knowledgeable. He's with me every Sunday on Fox News. He's a friend, and that's why he's also a pain in the butt, because I joke around with him all the time. And you see us, sometimes we agree or disagree, but he's a pal, he's a colleague. Mark, what do you tell Grace to do in a minute that we have?
By the way, David, we agree a heck of a lot more than we disagree. And
absolutely.
You've already given her pretty much all the answers.
You also have to admit that your suit and ties are much better since hanging out with me.
They have to be. They had better be. That's right. We try to match colors. You've already given her pretty much the answers, which is, you know, she has to eat more fruit and vegetables. Fiber is key. Whole grains is the other thing. Less fat, all of which you've said, less fatty foods. And less alcohol would be the other thing that you have to add. And there's some studies also that show that aspirin may be of some advantage. And clearly, as you said, she has to get screened, and especially with her family history, and make sure that there isn't a genetic component here. But that, and exercise, more exercise.
Grace, thank you. I hope it answered your question. And look for us online. And always, you're more than welcome to call in. Let's go to David from Harlem. David,
good morning.
Dr. Samadi here.
Well, good morning, Dr. Samadi. It's a pleasure talking to you. I listen to you for years now in your various media.
Thank you very much.
I have two rapid-fire questions because I like to get the answers. I know the lines are jamming, but
you got it.
My first question is, what is your recommendation or opinion about Cialis and BPH? And the second one is, do you have any opinions about herbal supplements and BPH or
I got you. BPH is an enlarged prostate. We give a lot of medications such as Flomax and Cordura. Those are blood pressure medications that patients may or may not want to take it. Recently, mm-hmm. study shows that Cialis 5 milligram not only can help you with your urination, but can also work help you with sexual function. I usually use it for young men in their early 50s that I don't want to give Flomax. I use Cialis 5 milligram, and it's perfectly safe, and you can take it once a day. I think as far as herbs are concerned, saw palmetto is the one that comes to mind for an enlarged prostate. What it does, it's supposed to shrink your prostate. It takes a little time. You won't see the effect of it quickly. But the thing about saw palmetto that I want you to be concerned about is it reduces your PSA, the blood test, to half. So if you are taking saw palmetto for a long time, be aware of doubling your PSA. If you have questions about prostate, elevated PSA or prostate cancer, call 212-365-5000. And the way you remember the number is the number of days in a year, 365. 212-365-5000. All right, let's go to James. James, good morning. Dr. Samadi here.
Good morning, doctor. Nice to talk with you.
Nice talking to you. Where are you calling from, James?
I'm calling from Potomac Falls, Virginia, Northern Virginia.
Virginia, nice to hear your voice. Talk to me. We have 2 minutes to answer your question, my friend.
Okay. I had mentioned to you on LinkedIn that I'm on testosterone pellets. And basically, just to tell you real quick, I went from Androgel to a Fortesta to Axiron to the shots. And then my doctor decided that it would be best to do the pellet therapy with Scottopell. And they insert 10 pellets every 5 months in my hip. My testosterone went from 181 to 1328. And you're saying that possibly that might be hard on my heart. My blood pressure has gone down, though, because I've lost 30 pounds. My waist, I've lost 5 inches. I'm not trying to gain bulk. I've actually changed my diet to exclude alcohol and to just go basically paleo.
Let me just jump in. No question that testosterone will build up your muscle and you're going to lose a lot of body fat, without a doubt. And I think that this was designed not for aging people or testosterone, the natural loss. It was really made for people who don't make any testosterone. And it's like now being used off-label. My concern is like walking around with a testosterone of 1,000, which is at the highest peak that you should be, it may affect your prostate. It may affect prostate cancer. And recently there was a FDA news that it may even cause some heart disease and heart attack. So as long as you're under surveillance of cardiologists and you have a good urologist, I think we're going to be okay. This is a discussion that's going to be continue. I want to see you next week to call in, and I want to answer your questions. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to go to Clayton and talk about the recent technology, and then we get to Dr. Siegel in a minute. Dr. Samadi here, World Health News on AM 970. We're bringing you not just medical aspect of it, but I want you to learn about technology, all these apps that are out there. And the medical technology is going to be a huge sector of this field. I couldn't think of anybody out there better in technology than our good friend Clayton Morris from Fox and Friends. Clayton is a friend. I see him every Saturday and Sunday on Fox and Friends weekend. He's the guru of technology on Fox. He's the one who introduced me all the Apple products. And that's why I thought it's great to have him. Clayton, good morning. Dr. Samadi here.
Well, great. Thank you so much for having me, Doc.
Of course. So I know you are really into tech. You know a lot about Apple. Tell me about some of these apps or things that Apple is coming up with to improve people's health and people's lives.
Well, this week I had a chance to go out to the Apple event to cover what I thought was just going to be the Apple Watch event, which, you know, I had a chance to meet some doctors out there during the fall announcement of the Apple Watch event, where it was really exciting for what it seemed like Apple was planning for HealthKit, which was built into the new version of iOS, the new software.
This was about a year ago that they came up with HealthKit, right?
Yeah, this was about it was announced last summer, and then we saw the first implementations of it really in the fall with the launch of the new iPhones. And
right.
then it was exciting because, well, you know, you're going to have this device on your wrist that would be able to monitor all sorts of different biofeedback that we'd never seen before, being able to use this Apple Watch. Well, this past week, remember the watch doesn't come out for another few weeks here in April, but past week at the Apple Watch event, Apple announced what was called Research Kit, and no one in the room had any idea that this was coming. You know, Apple is a very secretive company, and when they do software projects, they manage to keep it very quiet. Hardware, we get to learn about a little bit because we get leaks and things from China where some of the stuff is being put together. Research Kit is really a software framework, and Apple's goal is to try to move medical research forward towards changing medicine. And you can speak to this much more eloquently than I can, but how difficult it is to get people on board for research projects. I remember when I was at the University of Pittsburgh, you would see those papers up in the dorm rooms.
Absolutely.
You know, you would rip off the little tab at the bottom, you know, to call in, to go and, you know, whatever, if you wanted to make a few extra bucks.
And they give you $50 for having draw your blood. That's right.
Exactly. So what Research Kit allows companies to do, and universities, for instance, Stanford, is to launch apps like the Parkinson's M-Power study app. So if you go to the App Store right now, you'll see five of the apps that they worked on before the launch. For instance, the Parkinson's app from Meloria University. It's pretty remarkable, and they showed on stage what you could do with thousands of people giving you feedback for a research study instead of a few hundred people. So now, since they launched this past week, tens of thousands of people have already signed up for these research studies. And doctors are saying, look, in what would take normally years to get this number of people involved in
tremendous
in this kind of data, we're getting it in a few days. For instance, the Parkinson's app is pretty remarkable. It has a tap test to show whether or not the tremors in the hand have progressed. So you launch the app with two taps back and forth with your fingers, you're able to monitor the speed with which you're able to do that. Then you hold the iPhone up to your mouth, and you simply say, ah, and the app is able to study the vibrations of your vocal cords. And, of course, for Parkinson's patients, obviously this is they're able to monitor.
That's true.
You can speak again much more about the medical.
Well, no. You sound like a real professor, and obviously you have studied this field tremendously, and you're up to par with the technology. I know they're doing the same thing with asthma, and also what I heard was they're putting these sensors under the skin, I believe, that can actually monitor your glucose level continuously for diabetic patients. Were you able to see any of that over there?
Right, and so what you're able to do with, you know, all of these different companies, for instance, iHome and other companies have built different devices that plug into the iPhone and use the different applications. So the Glucose Success app was built in partnership with Apple from the Massachusetts General Hospital, and they hope the app will further research into diabetes research, but also around the behaviors that affect your health. So it'll allow you to keep track of health behaviors for people with type 2 diabetes, such as physical activity,
Absolutely.
Diet, and taking their medicines. You can set reminders. It'll alert you, you know, right on the watch or, of course, on your smartphone to let you know when to take this particular medicine. You become part of this broader research kit, which, you know, obviously they don't have FDA approval for the iPhone being a medical device. I really think that this paves a roadmap so that eventually, you know, Apple and others can, you know, go and say, look, these smartphones are in the hands of all of these people around the world and around the country, and this really is a powerful device. Look at the data that we're getting. And they're able to go to the FDA and show that.
I think it's going to change the whole face of research. As you said, recruitment was always a huge problem, which I think through this technology we'll be able to get. Also, connecting the doctors with the patients is also going to be much easier. And I think because of what you just said, I'm going to buy one of those fancy watches, the Apple watches, that's different prices. We're going to have you more often every Sunday. You're going to be with us to bring this technology. And send me the summary of what you said. I would love to post it on our blog. Thank you so much. We have Clayton Morris. Thank you so much for being here, Clayton.
Doc, it's always a pleasure.
Thanks a lot. We're going to go on a commercial, and we'll be right back with Dr. Mark Siegel talking about Obamacare and his recent article in New York Post.
Now for all your health questions, 1-877-970-2999.
In times of crisis, New Jersey's broadcasters are always there. That's because of the strength of broadcast and the power of the airwaves, but most of all because of the dedication of our great New Jersey broadcasters. When the power's out, the internet's down, and cell phone and wireless networks are unavailable, there's no more reliable and trusted source of information than local radio. New Jersey broadcasters are part of the communities that we serve, and Sandy reminded all of us that our broadcasters don't hesitate to put themselves in harm's way to bring critical information to our neighbors. Hi, this is Paul Rotella from the NJBA, and I'm proud to say that's just the beginning. Local radio and TV reach more New Jerseyans than all other mediums combined. And the best part is that it's all for free. Every day across the Garden State, local radio stations like this one serve communities in extraordinary ways, warning us about hazardous weather events, rescuing kidnapped children with Amber Alerts, and creating awareness about important health and safety issues. So keep listening, New Jersey. We're New Jersey's broadcasters, and we're always on the air when you need us most. This message sponsored by the New Jersey Broadcasters Association and this station.
All right, so we are here with my good friend, Dr. Mark Siegel, who is with me every Sunday on Sunday House Call. We have, Mark, we have helped tremendous number of people out there. I know everybody all over U.S. is watching us. You're more than welcome to come anytime you have important topic. This is your home, AM 970, World Health News. My name is Dr. David Samadi. If we don't get to you today, email me or call me, 212-365-5000, about the show, and also we're going to post it all over our blog, samadimd.com. All right, Dr. Siegel, Obamacare. I know from day one you forecast that this is not going to do well. Are we better off, like 2 years after that whole noise about Obamacare? Are patients getting better access, better care? Are they paying not as much as you thought? What's going on? In your New York Post, you were very clear. Obamacare stinks. And you have a way to show your emotion.
Well, look, more people are covered with insurance than were covered before. But the problem is, overall, the system may not be getting you the access you're used to. And there's a watered-down effect. Let me start with the issue of narrow networks. Under the Obamacare policies, you know, you go to the exchange and you get a narrow limitation of the number of doctors you can have. And I said in the New York Post that I had a patient with severe psoriasis who I was treating, and then the doctor that I was using wasn't taking it anymore, and I had to use a lesser treatment. And somebody wrote to the New York Post guy, and editor who knew him, and said, you know, I don't believe that that actually happens. So let me tell you a story. I was at a dinner the other night, and someone said to me, you know, there are only two doctors in New York who can do prostatectomies properly. And one is Dr. David Samadi. And I said to him, I don't really believe there's a second one. And the point
Thank
is...
Thank you. You're being very kind.
No, but I'm not. I really mean that. I mean, look, you have laparoscopic training. You have open training. You have, what is it, 6,000 cases
yes.
now? You know, you do it in an hour and a half. People get out the same day. Well, if I was a patient with a prostate cancer, God forbid I ever have that, why would I go to anyone else? And here's the reason. Narrow networks. Because I can't ask you to take every possible insurance under the sun that may pay you a very limited amount. That's the problem with Obamacare. One problem is the narrow networks. Doctors like you and doctors like me are not going to take every possible insurance.
So here's what's going on also. I mean, there's so much pressure on the hospitals nowadays. They're reducing the payments. They are also in April 2015, which is only like a couple of weeks from now. They're coming, Medicare is coming in with some like rating system where you get like 5 stars. It's almost like these letters outside the restaurants. You have A, it's a good restaurant. B is a bad restaurant. C, if you go in, you're going to get stomach pain and you're going to die. So based on what's going on over here, they have the patient surveys that all goes into Medicare. Then they give you a rating to the hospital. And so these are the things that they look at: long emergency room wait time in general, care transition, cleanliness, pain management. So how do they judge these hospitals? If somebody wants to please the patient, they would give more morphine, they would give more Percocet to keep the patient happy, as opposed to the quality of care. Maybe the doctor is really a good doctor, but he doesn't think he should be on Percocet on all this stuff. Are the doctors and hospitals being judged by all these guidelines and all these like pressure that's coming down from Obamacare?
That's a really great point, because the real way to take care of a patient, and you and I have talked about this on Fox News a lot, it's about the art of medicine. You know the science, and then when you apply it on a patient-by-patient basis, you tell the truth. And you may say to the patient, I don't want to give you that pain med. You know what? He's going to write in a survey that you're a terrible doctor because you won't give him what he asked for. And that's going to put us in a very, very compromised position. I think there's way too much evaluation going on. Let's recognize that quality of care is hard to put a number on. I mean, it's like the PSA. You were talking about the PSA before, David. I always say the PSA is as good as the doctor evaluating it. It's not a number. It's what you do with the number.
Well, there's an art to it, and I think like you really need to be in it and be the expert. Just like I would never like really try to diagnose pneumonia, which is all your field. So I think the value of experts is absolutely important. I want to take a quick break, and I want to come back with more questions about this whole Obamacare and what we're going to be talking on Fox News today. I know childhood obesity and diabetes is very close to you. You have had a lot of initiatives, interviews from McDonald's to delis, and now today you have something going on with the cafeteria and school system and how private sector can help with this. So when we come back, we'll have Dr. Siegel talking to us. Dr. Samadi here from Lenoxville Hospital, World Health News. Dr. Siegel treats his patient with Z-Pak. I treat them with my music, which is a lot more effective, and they would never get resistance to my music or get immune. Mark, so good to see you. We're going to be on Fox News at 12:30 talking about a lot of topics. In case you didn't catch us over here, you can follow us on TV on Fox News. We're going to be talking about renal disease today as a first topic, and how to prevent it, how to recognize you have a kidney disease. But the second topic today is going to be about childhood obesity and diabetes and the nutrition and diet that our kids are having in the school. What's your report on, and what are you going to be talking about?
You know, I was a big critic, as many are, of the National School Lunch Program that Michelle Obama initiated about 5 years ago, because we've been reading everywhere on social media about kids saying, look, you give me an apple, but it ends up on my plate. I'm not eating it. You can't force feed this stuff. So I went to Union City, New Jersey this week expecting more of the same, but I found that a private company called Chartwell's that actually serves over 2 million kids around the country is using serving stations and is using Chinese food.
Making
and is
it more fun
fajita.
For the kids.
Yeah, fun, interactive, baked, healthy,
but healthy
and tasty and healthy. Those are the two key words, tasty but healthy and interactive. The kids get to choose their own menu. Very exciting.
That's right. Is the key to their success is because they sat with the parents and teachers and the students and said, what do you want to eat? And they went back to the to the board and came up with this, or why is this a success and not other places?
Well, that's part of it, David. What you just said, there's this camaraderie. They can go on a website. There's an app. They can choose their own menus. They can talk about it. The other thing is that the food tastes great. So they're all day long, they're looking forward to the meal. Don't forget, a lot of these are very, very poor kids. They can't afford to go to restaurants. I wanted to come back to this cafeteria the next day because the food was so good.
All right, you think Michelle Obama is eating any of that food in the White House?
I think she better pay attention to this because private solutions oftentimes switch things and put a better spin on it. It's much better now.
I agree with you. So we're going to be on Fox News. The program is coming to an end. We heard about colon cancer screening. We heard about Obamacare. If we're not getting to a lot of live questions, it's because of limited time, but come on samadimd.com. Or call the office 212-365-5000. I'll see you next Sunday and hope this was helpful to you guys.
Tengo un Dios admirable en los cielos y el amor de su Espíritu Santo. Por su gracia yo soy hombre nuevo y de gozo se llena mi canto. De su imagen soy un reflejo que me lleva por siempre en victoria.
You've been listening to World Health News with Dr. David Samadi. To contact Dr. Samadi, please call 212-365-5000. That's 212-365-5000. Join us again next week at this same time for more of World Health News with Dr. David Samadi.